Brandon Novak joining us in studio.
Thank you, fellas. Thank you.
Today is a monumental day. 8 years today.
It is. Today, this very moment, 8 years of continuous sobriety. Concurrently.
Good for you, man.
Consecutively, in a row.
Incredible.
So, that song, Dr. Feelgood. What is that? Does it do any when you hear that?
I love it, man. It takes me that to that, back to that, like, nostalgic.
Yeah.
The reality is I love drugs and alcohol.
Yeah.
I loved them more than I loved anything else in life.
Same.
But it came to a point in my life where, like, the party ended and it turned into a full-blown hostage negotiation where I was never allowed to leave.
Yeah.
And realized that, like, the party had ended. And I had matured and I was no longer accepting of the outcome that I had created for myself.
Can I tell you a moment that really got to me in your story? I've read every book that you've written.
And I apologize for that. I'll start there.
Dude, Dream Seller, Streets. I think it was Streets of Baltimore, where one of my favorite skaters of all time, one of the only skaters that I think other sports feared, was Mike Vallely. If you don't know Mike Vallely, look him up. He is now the lead singer of Black Flag. But he was a skater, and he actually had a very viral clip about 15 years ago of him fighting four Jeep bro dogs that tried to attack another skater. If you went at Vallely, you better put him down or he'll kill you.
Yeah.
And you were on a team with him, and you guys would do demos, and you would skate, and he was almost like a John Harbaugh-style coach, but for skaters. And he saw you in a pretty bad way at a demo. And I would have been, I tried to put myself in your shoes. Thank God I've never had to walk the glass-covered path you did. But it was the portion of the book where you disappointed Mike Vallely that I was worried for you. Because Vallely will teach you with fists.
He's that hard love kind of, and the feeling is very mutual, right? And so as a kid touring with him and the other Pal Peralta team riders, I was with my idol, a guy that I admired. Yet feared more than anyone in this earth. So I knew that I was already knew in my mind I was walking on thin ice, eggshells at best. And it was only a matter of time before the jig was up and I was exposed for what the real deal was, which happened.
You were like going behind ramps to get sick. You weren't landing
throwing
anything.
Up, like just a complete embarrassment, really. And I couldn't see that because the disconnection from reality was absolutely insane. And I lived in my own reality to where, like, it made sense to me. And I'm the kind of guy still today that if it doesn't make sense to me, it's wrong, is my perspective to most things. So he played a big part in not only my addiction and my skateboarding world, but strangely enough, my recovery. You know, because then when I got sober and I looked back and realized, like, I always thought that I was hurting myself and it was me and I was the one that slept with me and I affected me. And that was just the selfishness and self-centered within me that never allowed me to see that, unfortunately, all these people that love me around me were like addicts, except they missed out on the best part, which was actually consuming the drug and enjoying the high. They just had to deal with all like the death, the destruction, the turmoil that comes with that. So I went back and recently saw him at the Do Tour. And him and his wife have this new house, and he was just such a humble, nice guy, and he gave me the biggest hug, and he's like, dude, I'm blown away by the accomplishments that you have.
He has to be proud of you, considering where you were to where you are now. You're a success story, Brandon Novak, in the way that, and I'm going to throw some names out here that might not mean a lot to people. Brandon will know. The Pappas brothers.
Yeah,
Taz and Ben Pappas. Taz still with us. Ben is not,
in
both
peace.
Of which... Got into heroin, got into meth. At one point, the Pappas brothers were number one and number two in the world in vert skating, and Tony Hawk was number three. They were the number one rivals to Tony Hawk.
Yeah, he was struggling.
He was,
struggling
to keep up with these guys. But unlike you, the success story, it got them. And one isn't here anymore because of some pretty dark stuff. Ben and Taz is now, I think, like a window washer or something. That's rough. So I'm glad you and Vallely have that relationship.
It was such a profound experience because, again, going back to what I said, I absolutely love drugs and alcohol. And the crazy thing about my life today is that I'm just consumed by drugs and alcohol, except I do not use them.
Yeah.
And I've created a very nice life from recovering from them. And by way of, like, you know, I own these sober living homes. I've just opened up my my own treatment center in Wilmington, Delaware, Redemption Addiction Treatment Center. And I travel the world and I raise all this money to provide a scholarship fund because what I refuse to do is never let price be a deterrent as to why somebody cannot find safe, adequate treatment and recovery. if someone didn't pick that phone up when I called 8 years ago today, literally, I'd be in that plot that my mother bought me.
God.
That's still over there in O'Donnell Heights. Why she bought me a plot in O'Donnell Heights is beyond me. Like, that's not a dream place for someone to call it quits.
Right.
But, you know, so how dare I not pay this forward?
Yeah.
Like, that does not sit right with me.
And you're a man of your word. You're a man of your word because you put your number out there all the time.
Call me, 610-314-6747. Me or one of my team members. I'm human. I can only answer so many calls. And we will do everything in our capability to get you the help that you need.
And, yeah, and we got a lot to talk about. I mean, we got to take a break, get to some sports. But we'll talk about redemption, like you said, in Delaware. Open now, Brandon Novak. Our past does not have to dictate our future. Doing great things today marks 8 years of sobriety, which is incredible. And can we talk about maybe BAM a little bit on the other side, or is that a no-fly zone?
You know, we can get into the, you know, I think what the general public probably can already know and see.
Yeah. Our hopes for him.
Yeah.
It comes from a place of hope.
Yes, of love and hope, absolutely.
Yeah. We'll talk about that after sports. More with Brandon Novak. It's a perfect name for it because the guy's the definition of it. Redemption. Brandon Novak joining us in studio. As Scott alluded to before we went and took a break for sports, real quick, it'd be disingenuous of us if we didn't ask briefly about how BAM might be doing, you and BAM might be doing, what your hopes are.
That's so upsetting. I thought we were going to go back to how great I dressed and how great I was, and you go right to BAM.
How you smell impeccable. How you smell like a sunrise.
I mean, like, listen, we actually kind of have a connection through you and these guys.
You two joined us on a Zoom, remember?
Yeah, you had BAM with us. Yeah. It's on YouTube. You can see it. But it's so weird because these are like weird full circle moments for him and me and us and all of us because we grew up on those guys and you know what I mean? And like we do have a genuine love for all of these guys. They made us laugh so much and they sacrificed so much for us. So when you see someone like BAM where it's like he's just he can't get it together. It's more than just some celebrity guy. Like it's BAM. You know what I mean?
People always wonder how I ended up in Westchester, a Baltimore born and raised kid.
Yeah.
How did I end up there? How did I end up in BAM's world and Viva La Bam? And this is how it took place. BAM and I had grew up and skating at the skate park. Me and Bucky would go to the skate park.
Bucky Lassie.
Shout out, Bucky. Yeah.
What's up?
Baltimore legend, Bucky
Lassie.
What's up,
Matt Dove?
That's it. Well, the boys. And Bucky and I would go to the skate park cheapskates. We had met BAM.
Yeah.
BAM's parents took us in. They'd allow us to stay at their house during the weekend. And doing that, BAM and I became like best friends. We skated alike. We dressed alike. We looked alike.
You guys are also very young kids in a late teen, early 20 scene. So in a couple of young, like we call them grommets.
Yeah, totally. 13, we're accepted by the older heads.
Exactly. That was a unique distinction to go, okay, you're 13, 14, but you go as hard as we do.
Yeah,
welcome.
Yeah, you've arrived at that point. And so BAM and I would always practice for this one particular contest that took place in Bricktown, New Jersey, the NSAs.
Yeah.
Every year, I'd win or he'd win. One year I didn't show up. Bucky goes, BAM says to Bucky, yo, where's Novak? Novak's on heroin.
Mm.
BAM, being so young, said, what's that? Had no idea what it was. That's how young he was. BAM's career continues to excel. He blows up, makes CKYs, becomes this household name, millionaire. Mine steadily declines. I'm like a homeless heroin addict roaming around the streets of Fells Point. And one day I go into Select Skate Shop.
Yeah.
Remember? And I go to hit them up for some money, and they said, we're not giving you money, but BAM was here with the Toy Machine team yesterday and did a demo, left his phone number, said, if you want to get off heroin, call him, and he'll help you. A week later, I decide to call. I go to that 7-Eleven up on Broadway, where all the guys hang out and look for work in the morning, and I put 50 cents in the payphone, and it's only 50 cents to my name, so I'm like holding the phone ready to, because if the machine picks up, it takes my 50 cents. That's like a lifeline. BAM answers the phone. What are you doing? You ready to get clean? You want to start skating? And that night, he had me on a Greyhound bus from Baltimore to Westchester, had moved me in, took me to Fairman Skate Shop, got me all new clothes. And that's where my integration or merge into Pennsylvania started. And he'd kick me out a lot. I'd come back.
And the Margera family, too. Let's not forget Phil
they
and
totally
April.
How many years? Okay, but how many years did that go on until you finally got?
Years. I'd say around 10 years in and out.
Still took.
And then finally, I kind of created a life of my own. I got engaged up there, and And finally it took. So Bam, like, kind of, in a way, if he didn't get me out of here, Baltimore, and extend that offer.
That was the first step.
Yeah.
With a lot of stumbles in between.
So many.
But now we're sitting here, I'm holding a pamphlet.
Yeah.
For redemption.
I believe that I went through what I went through to, A, be a vessel for my friend, when he's ready to kind of find his way, if he chooses sobriety or not. Because I love him. There's nothing I won't do for him, and I'm a friend to him till the day that I die, like he always has been for me.
Yeah.
But through his understanding, his compassion, and his acceptance, it allowed me to find my sobriety, which has now turned into Redemption Addiction Treatment Center, a facility that I have opened in Wilmington, Delaware.
Now, when Bam gave you the phone number, you called, and it helped. Now, you're there for Bam, and he knows that, but he's not accepting it. Where is he at? You've been there, so where is he at in the course of this spiral that he just can't? What is he dealing with that he just can't say, yes, it's time?
I think it's a combination of things. It's not just one, and that's the complexity with alcoholism and addiction. It's not that simple. It's not a black and white, one size fits all. Here's the instruction manual. Do this. You get that. The reality is, and when we're caught up, we are disconnected from reality, that the abnormal becomes the normal. So, like, I think you're insane for the logical approach that you take for a successful outcome because, like, I have it figured out. And what's
he
even...
Dude, his Instagram is shocking.
But look at his resume. Yeah. His resume states that he has had it figured out. And he's done things that the majority of the world would have only dreamed to be able to
do. And he can
again. So how do you tell someone at that point that they don't really know what they're doing? It's insane.
It's also hard, too, when you have a pretty nice bucket of money.
Yeah.
To work with, like, when you have nothing left, and those funds are finite.
Yeah.
But he still has them, and when, you know, you can fuel what you're going through. I'm going to take a quick call, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
This gentleman's been holding for a little bit. He knew you were coming on. Chris, good morning, man.
Good morning. How are you?
Good, man. It sounds like Mr. Novak here might have lent you a hand a ways back.
He sure did. So we kind of grew up skating together. And my life got pretty bad, pretty out of control. And he was working for a treatment center in Florida, and I reached out to try to see if I could get in. And that didn't work out, but he helped me get into somewhere else. That was in January of 2019, and I've been clean ever since.
My man.
Yes.
My man.
Yes.
Hell yeah, Chris.
Okay, Chris. I hear you. That's my
guy.
You know
exactly who he is.
I actually brought Chris in for one of those stunts I pulled with my mother.
Yeah.
We showed up one day, and Chris completely decorated her house like the Griswolds kind of deal. She wanted no parts. She just wanted her cigarettes and Pepsi.
Dude, we have so many messages here.
Yeah.
Brandon helped me get into treatment in 2019. Brandon helped me. I helped my ex get into a rehab 2 years ago. He called to talk to him and give him courage. My 8 months sober is the same as Novak's. It is wild. This makes me so happy. And you do put your number out there, and I know that firsthand because about a year or two ago, I called you.
Yeah.
Not for me,
but
for someone in my scope that, you know, if I'll tell the story privately at some point off air for a listener or a friend ever wants to know, but you picked up immediately. Gave us tools immediately, and that person is recovering because of the promise that you make and you uphold to people saying, if you need help, call. The same way when you called Bam, he picked up and helped you. You do the same for others. And this, I love what you said earlier before we went to break. You said price shouldn't be prohibitive of your recovery. And is that what Redemption
That's
provides?
Exactly why I created the facility that I am now the owner and operator of, Redemption Addiction Treatment Center. In sobriety, I learned that we create the environment that we seek.
Yeah.
The reality is I don't play well with others. I hate the word no, and failure is unacceptable. So I created a facility where no one can tell me no to helping somebody. I am the boss. And if I believe that someone needs the help and they're willing to do what we suggest, come on, we will help you.
And has Redemption, have you, you know, when you go to treatment, you learn what to do and also what not to do. But I would imagine, how many times did you go to treatment?
13 inpatients.
So in those 13, did you model redemption as to what you liked and didn't like about all of those places?
Amazing question. That's exactly what I did. I had been to so many facilities, and I was a rather unruly client, if you will, and didn't want to be in any of them until I was ready to be in them.
Exactly.
So in creating this environment, I made it the least amount of institutional as possible. There's art. There's colors. It's a vibe, and I created an environment where I believe people want to be as opposed to have to be, because we end up there through bankruptcy, termination, divorce. You know, nothing good leads us to treatment.
Yeah.
So every employee that I've picked, I said to myself, if I was sitting in this chair as a client, how would I feel about this man or woman talking to me?
Being and, at her.
And the vibe of the place.
Yeah.
You don't want it to be feel like you're being institutionalized.
I want you to want to be there, not feel like you have to be. Yeah. It's all, that's the
Brandon, deal. You described it earlier as a hostage negotiation. Now, classic hostage negotiation is usually one person negotiating with an army of people represented by maybe one person out there. In this hostage negotiation, who are you negotiating with?
Me, but the reality is I have no say-so in my matter, because the disease of addiction is so much more powerful that it no longer allows me to have a say-so in my life. So I'm literally, and that's why I got beat every time, because I always underestimated the opponent that I was up against, because I believed that I kind of had an idea of how things went, only to realize what I had known is that I had no idea about anything. So once I kind of, the day that I admitted, the day that I admitted defeat was the day that I secured the ultimate victory. It's kind of an oxymoron.
Wow, man. I got a little chill on that one.
God, that's incredible.
Yeah. That was a good one.
If people want to reach out, there's a lot of people out there that need help, family members that need help. What do they do right now? Because as you celebrate your 8 years sober today, at this moment, could be the beginning of someone else's journey. What do they do?
They can reach out to us directly, 610-314-6747, or go to redemptionaddictiontreatmentcenter.com, or go to my website, brandonnovak.com, all one word. For my 8-year anniversary, we've created this board. We've made 50 of them. They will never be made again. We will be selling them, and every dollar that comes from the sales of these boards go to a scholarship fund that will create free treatment opportunities, again, for people that do not have the ways and
means. God, you're one of the best of us, man. Brandon Novak joining us in studio. We're going to put all these links up online.
It's a lot of links.
We're going to put everything up. If you missed any of that, at JSS 98 Rock. Thank you, Brandon.
Love you, boys.